Welcome to Worship with Messiah Online. We're glad you're with us today. This Sunday is All Saints Day. It is the day when we remember those we have lost, as well as the Christians who lived before us and have testified to their faith. So I invite you to spend some time today just remembering those who have gone before you. Our Caring Hands food drop-off will be Monday, November 6th from 9 to 11 a.m., and we're also holding our Thanksgiving food drive. You can help the hungry this holiday season through this ministry with, again, Caring Hands food pantry. You can pick up a bag and return it by November 20th, or just drop off some extra food this month to help people in need have a Thanksgiving dinner. And this month, we'll have our Thanksgiving Eve service, including Holy Communion and our Pi Social, on Wednesday, November 22 at 7 p.m. And please keep Pastor Bob and all those who traveled with him to Uganda with Hope for Kids in your prayers. Now with that, let's begin worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed.
Let's pray. Almighty God, you have taught us in your Son, Jesus Christ, that the law is fulfilled by love. Help us to receive your love and inspire us to love you with all our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. And teach us how to love our neighbors as ourselves. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our scripture reading today is from Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning at the first verse. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live, by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey, so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. This is the end of the reading.
Cry out to worship, whose glory taught the stars to shine. Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing, but this joy is mine. With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. The song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more.
Who else would cry for our redemption? Whose resurrection means our rise? There is a time without to sing of all you I have eternity to drive.
With a thousand hallelujahs, we magnify your name. You alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. Lord Jesus, this song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs in the
book of Deuteronomy consists mostly of several speeches or sets of instruction from Moses to the people of Israel as they are about to enter the Promised Land. They'd been out in the desert for 40 years and several months, almost 41 years. It is not true, by the way, that they were out there so long because they wouldn't ask for directions. They were out there so long because when they got to the Promised Land the first time, several of their leaders were afraid to go in. So God made them wait plus or minus 40 years until all the leaders who were afraid to go in had died before they could actually enter into the land. Now they're camped on the plains of Moab, right across the Jordan River from the Promised Land, and they are getting ready to finally go in. And Moses wants to make sure they are really ready. Many of the generation that left Egypt have already died. Many of the people who are alive today were not at Mount Sinai when they received the commandments. And the situation will be different in the land than it was in the desert. So Moses makes a series of speeches that restate, or more accurately, reinterpret the law that the people have already received in a way that can guide them when they get into the Promised Land. The people received the law, including the Ten Commandments and the Covenant Code, as a gift after leaving slavery in Egypt. You see, when they were slaves in Egypt, they didn't need law because they simply had to do whatever the Egyptians told them. But if they're going to be free people, they need principles, they need advice, and they need some detail as to how they're going to live together. And that's what Moses gives them in the book of Deuteronomy, which literally means second law. The question facing the people of Israel is twofold. First, how will they respond? How will they respond to the gift of God's law, which, if followed, will help provide order and help them live in community? Second, how will they live in the land that had been promised to their ancestors and in which soon they will live? And Moses, in Deuteronomy, presents to them the posture that they are to have toward God and toward God's commands as they prepare to go into the Promised Land, so that their lives will be fruitful and they will thrive or flourish. The heart of the passage we just heard is a prayer called the Shema, a Hebrew word meaning hear. The prayer begins with, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one." The word Lord is typically used in our English translations where the original Hebrew word was Yahweh, meaning I am who I am, or maybe even more mysteriously meaning I will be who I will be. This is the name God gave to Moses when Moses asked who he should say sent him. You might hear the beginning of this prayer, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord, Yahweh, your God is one," in a variety of ways. Some people have taken it to mean that God is a singularity, a simple, concrete, easy to grasp and understand being. But of course, this isn't true. For example, some rabbis say that the Hebrew Bible, what we Christians call the Old Testament, describes 27 different faces of God, or different ways that God relates to creation. Christians understand that God is one, there is one God, but that God is expressed in three persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And don't ask me to make that math work, please. In the Genesis creation story, God says, "Let us make man in our image." Us, our. God is complex and not easily grasped by our finite minds or explained by our human language, which is why, on some level, our talk about God has to be symbolic or metaphorical, because we are using human language to describe a God who is far above and beyond our human experience. It's better to understand this language: "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one." It's pointing to the commandment to worship only one God. In a polytheistic culture, this is the demand of this God, the demand of this Lord, who had revealed his name to Moses and then brought the people out of Egypt. That this God, Yahweh, not some other local God, will be the God of the people of Israel. The called for response is not only to worship only this God, but to love Yahweh, to love the Lord, to love this God with an extravagant, committed, undivided love. To love this God with a love that includes conscience, heart, essence, soul, and vitality, might, or strength. If the people of Israel can do this, they will be a community oriented toward morally correct decision making. They will be a community with ethical values, and they will be a community full of energy for life. This prayer stands at the center of the Jewish faith. It is as familiar to the average Jewish person as the Lord's Prayer is to the average Christian. Many Jewish people recite it twice a day and is called for by this passage. Observant Jews go to great lengths to pass it on to their children. But we Gentiles, we non-Jews, can learn from it too. Love God. Love God with everything you are and everything you have, your heart, your soul, your strength. Love God with your very life, which Old Testament scholar Catherine Schifferdecker points out is probably a better translation than soul, because ancient Israel didn't really conceive of the existence of a disembodied soul separate from the body. Love, in this passage, is more than an emotion. In the Old Testament context, love consists of loyalty, faithfulness, and obedience to the terms of your sovereign's covenant. In this sense, love is much more an action or a series of actions than it is an emotion. Unfortunately, as we learn from the rest of the Old Testament, the people of Israel weren't really all that good at these actions that expressed loyalty, faithfulness, and obedience. The language of love and the language of covenant can be found elsewhere in the Old Testament in the context of marriage, which sometimes serves as a metaphor for understanding the relationship between God and the nation of Israel. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, for example, God is said to love Israel, and this love is a matter of God's heart. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, beginning at verse 7, we read, "The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other people, for you were the fewest of all peoples. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt." While we need to be careful to differentiate between the Old Testament nation of Israel and the government of Israel today, the words of Jewish scholar John Levinson are helpful in understanding the relationship between Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God who revealed his name to Moses, and the Old Testament people of Israel. He writes, "The special status of Israel rests not upon her merits, her strength, or numbers, or intelligence, or honesty, but upon something irrational, a passion, an affair of the heart, not the mind, In short, a love. Israel is singled out by and for the love of God. If God's love is something irrational, a passion, an affair of the heart, then the love it calls forth from us in response as people who have been grafted onto Israel's covenant relationship with God through the work of Jesus Christ. Our response should also be a matter of the heart. The Shema calls us to love God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, better all your life and with all your might. Love God with everything you are, your heart, your soul, your strength. Love God with your life. Which brings us to a passage from the Good News According to Mark. This is the first message in a series we're calling The Cradle That Holds the Christ Child. All of Scripture, including the Old Testament, is intended to point us to Jesus. In this series, we'll explore the connections between Old Testament and New Testament gospel texts, focusing mostly on texts from Mark's and Luke's gospel, helping to point us toward the coming of the Christ Child at Christmas. We will see how the New Testament picks up Old Testament concepts and language, but reinterprets them based on the conviction of the New Testament writers that Jesus is the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. So, from Mark chapter 12, beginning at the 28th verse, one of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," Jesus answered, "is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." "Well said, teacher," the man replied. "You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love God with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And from then on, no one dared ask Jesus any more questions. Now, Jesus usually had confrontational interactions with the teachers of the law, also sometimes called scribes. And the scribes were aligned with the Pharisees. But this teacher seems genuinely impressed with Jesus and wants to know what Jesus thinks about this question. And this question, which is the first or greatest commandment, the most important commandment, was a common question in first century Israel as people were struggling to figure out how to live as the faithful people of God while being occupied by the pagan Roman Empire. Jesus, who may have been at odds with the religious establishment of his day, despite being a faithful Jew, quotes from the Shema and adds to it a passage from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. Love your neighbor as yourself. Raises the question, how shall we love God? We love God by obeying God's commandments, by loving our neighbors as ourselves, which is the principle behind what we sometimes call the second table of the Ten Commandments. And we love God by teaching our children and our children's children to do the same. It is a matter of both the head and the heart. We live out our love for God by being obedient to the covenant into which God calls us. This covenant is not a burden. Instead, it is a gift from God given to us so that it may go well with you. Jesus' answer to this question would not have been considered controversial. it is well within the range of acceptable answers to this question in first century Israel. What would have been considered controversial, maybe even subversive, was the scribe's statement that these commandments were more important than burnt offerings and sacrifices. Loving God and loving your neighbor is more important than religious ritual? Who knew? Maybe even more controversial was Mark telling us that the scribe had answered wisely, and Jesus' agreement with him, saying that the scribe was close to the kingdom of God. Jesus had followed the Old Testament law, the Torah, to its center, to its very core, and he identified the two commands, two principles, at the center of all the Old Testament commandments. Everything else was just detail, detail about how to live out the love of God and the love of our neighbors. All of the Ten Commandments, for example, are detail about one of these two questions. What does it mean to love God? What does it mean to love our neighbors? Of course, as we learn from the failure of the people of Israel to keep these commands, following and keeping these commandments to love God and our neighbors requires what the Bible calls a new heart. The new heart comes to us when we receive forgiveness of our sins, of our failures and our mess-upedness, and we are set free from our sin, our failures, and our messed-up, selfish human nature. This experience of being forgiven and set free by Jesus inspires us to share that forgiveness and that freedom with others. The teacher's statement that these commands are more important than the sacrificial system, followed by Jesus' affirmation of that statement, shows us how Jesus' movement is anti-temple, or at best or worst, maybe counter-temple. And it shows us how Jesus actually replaces the temple. Kingdom behavior, loving God and loving our neighbors, is more important than religious ritual. It's more important than participation in the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. And it's more important than making the sacrifices required by the Old Testament. I often think that God gave the Old Testament sacrificial system because people thought they had to make sacrifices. This was a common view in ancient cultures. They weren't required because God needed the sacrifices. And I wonder if God abolished the system, saying enough, and offering Jesus as the final sacrifice because people thought they were earning something by making the sacrifices that God didn't need. But I want to take a step back a minute. How do we actually manage to love God and love our neighbors? Because it's tough. I'm convinced that we can only love in the way Jesus commands, that we can only have this unconditional love when we have experienced God's love in our lives and simply want to reflect that love to others. As we read in 1 John chapter 4, we love because God first loved us. Jesus offers a new, renewed heart, a new covenant through which we will be able to keep the Shema by loving God and our neighbors. Jesus also offers forgiveness. In Mark chapter 2, verse 5, he said, "My child, your sins are forgiven." Today, this might look to us as if Jesus is acting like a God. And then we might start to debate whether or not Jesus is God. But in first century Israel, this was shocking also, or even instead, because first century Jews understood that forgiveness came from participation in the temple and the Old Testament sacrificial system, which required the priesthood. And Jesus bypasses all of that, simply saying, "Your sins are forgiven." When the new covenant comes in Jesus' death and resurrection, what Jesus calls the new covenant in my blood, the great commandment can be fulfilled. Because being forgiven and set free by Jesus gives us new hearts. The temple and the sacrificial system are no longer needed. God gave them to Israel because Israel thought they needed them. But they are no longer necessary because Jesus is the final sacrifice. The teacher of the law in this passage says that these commands to love God and love our neighbors count more than sacrifices and burnt offerings. And Jesus agrees. Jesus' response points us to the kingdom of God, where no more sacrifices of this kind are necessary, and we are simply called to love God and love each other. So Jesus replaces the temple and fulfills the Old Testament system. As he says, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." And we commemorate his death, even celebrate his death, every time we receive Holy Communion. Throughout his public ministry, Jesus acted on the basis of compassion, love for the multitudes, for the poor, for the sheep without a shepherd. When asked about the greatest commandment, Jesus highlighted love. The love we can have for God and for our neighbors because of God's love for us, which we experience in the new covenant which Jesus brought by his death and resurrection. When we enter into the love of God, when we experience God's love in our lives, we are then able to respond by loving God and loving our neighbors. It was this love, God's love for us, that sent Jesus to the cross. The cross was the climax of Jesus' ministry, in which God's active, outgoing, healing love had been the trademark and the hallmark. The cross, followed by the resurrection, was where Jesus won the decisive victory over the power of evil in this world. In his 1979 book, The Aims of Jesus, Ben Meyer asks, "What, in the end, made Jesus operate this way? What energized his incorporating death into his mission, his facing and going to meet that death?" And Dr. Meyer goes on to answer his own question. What made Jesus operate in the way he did? What made him epitomize his life in the single act of going to his death? He loved me and handed himself over for me. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The answer to why Jesus did what he did for us can be found in one word: love. Jesus went to Jerusalem to die, to defeat the power of evil in this world, to win victory for the kingdom of God. And in the end, Jesus revealed that he was not a God with a small g. Jesus revealed that he is, in fact, the Son of God with a big capital G. Jesus wins the victory, conquers death and evil, and sets us free from their power. He brings forgiveness of sins, not just for first century Israel, but for all the world. And it is Jesus' love, most fully on display on the cross, that enables and inspires us to truly love God and truly love one another. Amen. For our confession of faith today, we're going to use an alternate statement of faith, not the Apostles' Creed, but an alternate statement of faith which stresses God's love. Please join me in this. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. As we come to our offering time today, I'm struck by the thought that on one level, love is a feeling or a commitment, but love is also action. Love is what we do. Loving our neighbor is largely about what we do for the least well-off among us. Your gifts to Messiah facilitate our ability to help care for the least well-off among us, those Jesus referred to as the least of these. Your donations, both to particular ministries like the Caring Hands Food Pantry and to our general budget, make it possible for us at Messiah to work for the benefit of those in need. You can give to Messiah in a wide variety of ways, writing a check to Messiah, leaving it in the offering plates when you're on site, or mailing it or dropping it off at our office, online banking or our website, or texting Messiah YL to the numbers on the screen. Thank you for your gifts to Messiah and for all you do to live out the love of God and change lives for the sake of the gospel. Please join me in prayer. God of mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hands to pour out your blessings upon us. Fill us with good things and inspire us to come to the help of all those in need. You have knit your people together in one communion, the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's join in the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now let's sing our sending song.
I believe there is one salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. Crucifixion, by his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is destined. In the hope of heaven, he's preparing a place for me.
receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord with joy. Thanks be to God.